Just to give you an example of something we closed very recently, it was a university deal, and royalty monetization is, as it says, we basically will upfront payment for a royalty stream that's being paid out over usually the life of the intellectual property. It could be 5 years, it could be 15, 20 years. In this case, University of Cincinnati Children's Hospital had a royalty that was coming to it from Glaxo's sales of a rotavirus vaccine. We basically acquired the rights to that royalty stream for a period of time. What's interesting of that is actually it's a tie to a stream of royalties. The inventors, university, and then a company, Avant, which actually then acquired the intellectual property from the university, then licensed it to Glaxo. So there was a stream of three royalties. Interestingly, and kind of uniquely, we actually acquired the royalty from both the inventors, the university, and Avant. So we have the entire royalty stream for that product. That is basically used by a university or by someone with a royalty stream or a company. Another publicly disclosed royalty deal with a large pharmaceutical company was with Aventis when we acquired the royalty rights for Lunesta, which was being sold by Sepracor. Again, usually these deals are done because the university or whoever it has wants to bring money forward because they have a more strategic need for that capital. And they could either go to the capital markets or they could look internally and see what assets do we have that we could capitalize and bring that money forward. And it's done very frequently with universities or inventors, and in some cases with a larger pharmaceutical company, one to help a short-term need or secondarily because of FTC needs to divest what may be a potential conflict of interest. Other types of deals we typically do, though, would be for, as I mentioned earlier, smaller companies that are looking for growth capital. And they have the option of looking for the capital markets, so whether they want equity or they want to go for additional debt structure, or they could look for something that is kind of a hybrid of that, and that's where we would come in with Paul Capital. Just to throw an example, last year, a company, Ossient in Boston, was in need to acquire a second product. What we did was basically give them, in essence, $70 million, so they could acquire a product from another company that was looking to divest it. They added that product to their portfolio to have more than one product in their bag when the reps went out, so they'd have a more effective sales presentation, have additional cash flow to provide for ongoing development of some other products they had in their pipeline. And what we did here is, in order not to overburden the product with a revenue interest, which is when you deal with a product like a royalty, we'll take a percent of a revenue that's being generated and use that to pay back our investment. In this case, we gave them a equity as well as a traditional debt as well as a revenue interest in order to customize it. That, as I mentioned earlier, is becoming more known, and also because of the current environment for a small company, very often a good alternative. So, as I said, when we do deals, it's typically 20 to 100 million. In that area, you know, the debt crisis has not had as much of an impact. There's still deals out there for the smaller companies. They still need to grow. Either that or they're going to go away. So they can't wait around like large pharmaceutical companies to weather the storm. They actually do need to continue to bring that product to market. And there is a growing need for alternative forms of capital. So even when there's a crisis, there's always somebody that benefits.